In the early 1800s, travel was terribly unreliable. You could walk or ride a horse. If you lived near a river, you could take a boat. But what if it rained and the road was deep in mud? And what if it didn't rain and the river was too shallow for your boat? Well, reliable, or at least fairly reliable transportation, came to Georgia in 1835. It proved to be very good for business. In fact, it still is. I'm talking about the railroad. At the turn of the 19th century, settlers were moving westward into Georgia's interior. Towns and farms were growing. So was the need for dependable transportation of people and goods. There were mules and stagecoaches. There were wagons pulled by oxen. But the roads they had to travel were awful.
The mud would be so deep, it could be 5 feet deep, that you would just completely embed not just the wheel of a wagon, but the very wagon itself. And then you have horses trying to pull or mules trying to pull the wagons through. So you can imagine if you have a bale of cotton traveling on a wagon, you're not going to get very far.
Waterways were the easiest transportation routes, and Georgia's most important early cities were built on rivers. Savannah, Augusta, Rome, Columbus. But river travel had its problems too. Floating downstream was easy, but traveling upstream against the current, well, that took a lot of elbow grease, rowing. That problem was solved when steamboats were invented, and boats could travel upstream powered by steam. Meanwhile, in England, some men figured out how to use a steam engine to pull cars on a rail. It began a revolution in transportation. In the South, the railroad came first to South Carolina.
At the time that the railroad was completed from Charleston to Hamburg, South Carolina, it was the longest rail line in the world. This was in 1833, and the rail was 136 miles long.
When Charleston's train made its first run, a large crowd turned out to celebrate the historic event. It seemed that everyone was cheering, but the city of Savannah.
The city of Savannah became very concerned when South Carolina constructed a railroad from Charleston all the way to Hamburg, South Carolina, which is just across the river from Augusta, Georgia. This would interfere with freight traffic on the Savannah River.
In no time, the South Carolina train was transporting Georgia cotton to Charleston, taking away business that used to go downriver from Augusta to Savannah. About the same time, in Athens, some businessmen were stuck in the mud.
These businessmen in 1830 were trying to build a cotton mill in Athens and had to move their machinery overland from the river, from Augusta to Athens. Got caught in the Georgia winter, had their six mule team wagons mired down for months, and were so exasperated that they decided then and there that they would build a railroad from Augusta to Athens.
In 1833, the Georgia legislature chartered the first two railroads to be built in Georgia. At last, a road that was good in all kinds of weather, dependable, affordable transportation. But that doesn't mean they were like today's trains, fast and safe. In fact, some of the early trains looked downright silly.
They looked like smokestacks on a wagon. It's amazing that they worked at all, but they did. I believe the speed was about 22 miles per hour, but people were constantly afraid they were going to blow up, and the smoke and cinders, whatever, created quite a ruckus.
They were belching, noisy, scary, loud pieces of equipment that no one had seen the likes of before. So in their imaginations, they were like some terrific monster, and there was a kind of awe that people had about them.
The locomotive spewed smoke and burning embers that sometimes set fire to houses and barns. The first passenger cars had no glass in the windows, so the people inside got the smoke and embers too.
You have to think about how hot it would be. No air conditioning. It's sticky hot in most of the year in Georgia, and you'd be traveling on in these passenger cars, sweating away, and so you'd open your window to get any kind of breeze that you can, and then the embers would come in and could potentially light your clothes on fire or settle in your hair. So you've got to constantly be on the alert, and you know, pity those who would sleep while this was happening.
Over time, the train, with all its imperfections, was accepted as fast, efficient transportation. Towns grew up along the railroad. Some of them, Cammack and Thompson were named for men who helped build the first Georgia railroad. But Georgia's most famous railroad town is Atlanta.
Well, the city of Atlanta would not have existed at all without the railroads. It was simply started as a marked spot on a survey map simply labeled as Terminus.
The new town was called Terminus because it was the end of a rail line from Tennessee. Terminus was renamed Marthasville and finally called Atlanta. By 1860, the new city was the major railroad center in the South. That made Atlanta busy and prosperous, and it marked a change in Georgia's history. Atlanta was the first important city in Georgia that wasn't on a river.
So it's the first really landlocked city that takes root in Georgia's history at this time. And it's ironic in some ways that it's now the most important city, the hub of the state. Many people at the time did not think that would happen. They thought it was impossible, that unless you had a good river that was navigable, you couldn't have a prosperous city. And Atlanta proved everyone absolutely wrong.
The new Georgia Railroad was constructed so that either steam engines or horses could pull the trains.
About Georgia's economic history, there are more stories to tell, so we'll be back. This is Georgia Stories 2. I'm Colin Sedor. Thanks.